I suggest you study this.
The views and opinions expressed on the Faygoluvers Podcast do not necessarily reflect those of us here at Faygoluvers.net. Some episodes may contain disturbing content. Discretion is advised.
I appreciate you doing this, eh?
Yeah, for sure, eh?
Fuck. I appreciate you doing this, huh?
Yeah, eh?
All right, man.
Fucking Canadian.
What's up, Juggalos, and welcome to the Faygoluvers Podcast. Today is April 9th, 2017. This is episode number 16. I am your homie Roscoe, and I'm going to be your host for this episode of the podcast. There has been a lot of big news dropping in the underground lately, and the last 2 weeks has been no exception. But before we get into that, we have that ninja, Sutter Kain, on this episode of the podcast. This ninja's been around for a long time. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with his work. We speak on his new project, Pull the Fucking Trigger. You're going to hear all about that in the interview coming up. We speak on his love for underground music. We even speak on his love for animals. Stick around to hear that. Last week's episode that we did with Mars was by far our most popular episode that we've ever done. And I'm 100% sure it's due to the controversy that was surrounding that episode. But if you did listen to that episode, you heard me featured on a radio show called Replicon Radio. I featured like a little 10-minute clip. On this episode of the podcast, we have one of the co-hosts of that show, Freaky P. He comes on and talks to me about his beginnings in Replicon Radio, the first time he ever heard an ICP cassette, his past experience in radio, and more. Definitely stick around to hear that too, ninjas. If you are hearing the sound of my voice right now, that means that the voting for the 2017 Faygoluvers Music Awards is officially over. I hope you ninjas got over there and voted. Definitely stay tuned to hear the results. Here's some dope announcements that I want to make before we get into the official news segment of the podcast. Natus's At the End of Time and Space box set is now officially available. Hit up the link in the show notes to see that. Tech N9ne's Dominions Collabos LP is now available as well. Hit up the link in the show notes to see that. And Boondocks' Billboard chart numbers have been revealed. Check it out. He made number 4 on the top rap albums, number 3 on the top independent albums, number 17 on the top albums, and check it out, number 47 on the top 200 albums. Fucking dope. Props to you, Boondocks. Let's get into the news.
Yeah, I got weekend orgies and, you know, it's all good, man.
Good to know.
The reason why I'm beating on my chest is because we don't know the producers who did these beats. You know what I'm sizzling? We don't want to disrespect them by putting it out, you know what I mean? This one is called Move, that I did with Mims, a remix for Move. Check it out.
When I say move it there, everybody best to do it moving. Yeah. Better do when the weather say and the party tech, the fool is ruling. Yeah. And I never got to read her paws, so give me the pennies and know I need her bra. Yeah. And the haters want to trip, but they really better dip when I'm yelling out Libertas. Yeah. When I'm off on a hammer mission, man, I'm crammed with ammunition. Yeah. You be looking at the camera glistening, damn, it's freaking fam is missing. Yeah. I don't want to be the killer, but the suckers are making me want to pick it up and squirt and begin it. Ascend to his vertical limit. Yeah. Murder your minutes, the Nina gets surgical with it. Yeah. If you tripping, chump, you need to stop. Yeah. Or the Nina pop, beaming the boss is about to bring the block. Yeah. For the green of guap, they know that this man is gritty. Your rap's hella weak now and it's kitty. Tech with the beast flow and it's spitty. And I'm straight from the Midwest, Kansas City. Picking it with the homie Mims. Who be the best? It's only them. Kicking the hell out your crony Nim with Louis V monogram on the Tims. I don't never give a damn about a hater, but I gotta know what you gon' do. Talking all that whoop-de-wop, you niggas make a move if you want to.
I gotta put some swag on it. Psychopathic shit. Forever the hatchet man.
We are definitely going to get into the shit with Tech N9ne and ICP, all that shit going on. But for now, I want to bring up this new track that was released by ICP, or more specifically, Violent J. The shit is called For Life. It is a cover song from an artist named Ray Sremmerd. Like Scotty mentions in the article posted on Faygoluvers, he has no clue who this ninja is, and I also have no clue who this ninja is. I've never heard of this song, but apparently it has over 500 million views on YouTube. Holy shit! The ICP cover video was released on April 1st, leading a lot of ninjas to believe that it was an April Fool's joke, In this ninja's opinion, it was meant more to be a poke at the mainstream, much like the music video for the Christina Aguilera Beautiful cover that was released recently. Say what you want about the song, I'm actually digging the music video. You can tell that a lot of time and work went into that shit. Hit up the link in the show notes to watch that or hear a sample of that song right now.
Fuck the internet, I'll be out here living life. I am paid the price.
You made it.
Put the necessary work in, and now I'm set for life. I like my Latin stay. I'm a single rich star, fucking hotties every night.
Twisted has announced that they will be releasing a comic book. That's right, Juggalos have been asking for this for years, and it's finally becoming a reality. The name of the comic book is Haunted Hions, and so far, right now, that's basically all the information that we have. We do have what appears to be the cover of the very first issue, however, this has not been finalized, so what we're seeing may not even turn out to be the cover of the first issue of Haunted Hions. Like I said, not much information about this right now, but stay tuned for more, ninjas. The trial for Calvin Hooker III, who is the dude who was charged with the murder of Thomas Cannibal Cottingham, actually started late last month. He was charged with that, aggravated menacing, endangering the welfare of a child, resisting arrest, and two weapons offenses. The first person to take the stand and testify against this dude was Amadi Muhammad, who was the woman that Cannibal actually saved. He saved her and her child. The entire confrontation was recorded by a dark camera bus. Delaware Online actually posted an article about the trial, and within that article you can actually read the detailed events of what happened with Cannibal coming from Amadi herself. Check out that link in the show notes, and much love and respect to our homie Cannibal.
Everybody just listen to me. I looked at you and smiled the other day. I thought you'd see me, but you didn't. I said I love you and waited for what you'd say. I thought you'd hear me, but you didn't. I asked you to come outside and play ball with me. I thought you'd follow me, but you didn't. I drew a picture just for you to see. I thought you'd save it forever, but you didn't. I made a fort for us back in the woods. I thought you'd camp out with me, but you didn't. I found some worms and stuff for fishing. I thought you'd want to go with me, but you didn't. I needed you just to talk to share my thoughts with. I thought you'd want to, but you didn't. I told you about this game, hoping you'd show up to play. I thought you'd surely come, but you didn't. I asked you to share my youth with me. I thought you'd want to, but you couldn't. My country called me off to war. You asked me to come home safely, but I didn't. Keep the ones you love close to you and make sure they know you love them all the time, because anything can happen at any time. Make sure whoever you love knows that you love them, because this world can be a pretty shocking place sometimes.
Y'all remember that poem? Well, check it out. That was from the ICP hotline back in the early 2000s. Violent J got that out of a book called A Second Helping of Chicken Soup for the Soul, which everybody and their mama is familiar with the Chicken Soup for the Soul books. It was actually written by a poet named Stanley Gebhardt in 1993, and it's called But You Didn't. Now, I personally believe that Violent J was never trying to pass that poem off as his own. I never believed that he wrote it. It's not his style. But as of last month, the ninja who originally wrote the poem actually put up a copyright infringement claim against the Insane Clown Posse, and he is suing them. I don't know how the fuck this is gonna work. ICP has never released that poem on any albums or anything that they've ever made money from ever, so we'll see how this turns out, ninjas. Twisted has announced four new vinyls that are about to be added to the Magic Ninja Entertainment vinyl collection. three of which we are just hearing of for the first time. These vinyls are the Necromancy picture disc, which we've already heard about, the Abominations picture disc, the Sucks to Be You / Return of the Pervert 7-inch, and the Too Many Freaks 10-inch vinyl that's going to be dropped. The Too Many Freaks track, of course, by Davey Suicide featuring Twisted. They just dropped a music video for that shit. It's pretty dope. You can check that out by hitting up the link in the show notes. Or you can hear Twisted's verse on that shit right now. Check it out.
Twisted.
Raised up. I'm angry. Hate fuck. Everything I ain't luck. Never came my way stuck. In the pain and the makeup. Cause I never wanted to be famous. Some of my aim is to lame fuck. So be nuts. The preach show became us. I rewrite shit like Angus. Yeah, I mean you can't contain us. From another dimension. Not to mention a fucking dangerous. And no intervention is saving us. From what's been gained to us. Hell of no, don't need for angel dust.
All right, here we go, homies. A little while back, Tech N9ne was on a radio show, Hot 97, where he talked about the rap game, hip-hop, his career, yada yada. They asked him some questions about ICP, Psychopathic Records, and Juggalos, and he gave his answers and shit. A little while later, ICP was also on Hot 97. You can actually see the entire hour-long interview by hitting up the link in the show notes. But they also spoke on Tech N9ne, and they actually spoke on his specific visit to Hot 97 and what Tech had to say about ICP, Psychopathic Records, and Juggalos. Here's what ICP had to say about Tech N9ne. It's kind of a long sound clip, but check it out.
Our problem is when Tech said, when you guys asked him, was your company blueprinted from ICP's company, which is Psychopathic Records?
Bing!
Right.
You know, most recognizable Juggalo logo. And he said, you know, I think Travis was more influenced by No Limit Records. That wasn't being truthful, man. You know what I'm saying? I love Tech. I'm not on here dissing him.
No, that's our boy. You know what I'm saying? It's just we gotta set some of this stuff straight.
Right? Not for our props.
No.
For the Juggalos. Okay,
because we gotta understand that Juggalos is what we do this for.
Right. So let's go back though. So you felt that Tech's assessment of their influence, of Travis's influence coming from No Limit, when you think in fact you know that it came from Psychopathic.
I know for a fact that Strange Music came out in 1999. Strange Music, Psychopathic Records. Use your own judgment if you think there's a similarity. But what I'll tell you is that Travis told my manager himself, we've read your book four times. All right. Trying to figure this thing out. This is on their come up. Now, I don't know what he would have to gain by gassing our manager up saying that. I don't know why he would say something like that. What benefit he's trying to gain out of gassing ICP's manager up, you know, but they absolutely got some love. Tech started receiving some love in Kansas City. All right. He wasn't doing much of anything for most part of his career. All right. Then all of a sudden, I think Angelic came out, and even the cover of Angelic, where he's got his back to the crowd and he took a picture, is a photo we did about 3 years earlier. You know what I'm saying? Same exact thing. We're standing like this with our back to the crowd. I'm not.
Man, that we came out with as a poster.
I know that I'm trying. I know I'm sounding like I'm dissing Tech, man. And I love Tech. This is
you just
sincere.
Want clarity.
For the Juggalos.
Right.
I don't give a fuck about us.
Well, what I hear you guys saying is just for the historical kind of chronological order of events of clarity.
Especially what we call the wicked shit. Which is where you're rapping totally free to say whatever the fuck you want, any way you want, and you're not worried about radio,
right.
MTV, none of that shit, fuck it.
No politics.
No politics. You say whatever you want, even if you make a corny, you know, soft butterfly song, or you're killing a motherfucker with an axe. You know, whatever you want to say.
Whatever you're feeling, you make.
Right. Yeah.
And do you feel that Tech, and you feel Tech is sort of part of that as well?
Absolutely he is, man.
Yeah, he said he goes crazy.
He goes crazy.
I didn't know it had a name. You know, I just motherfuckers be saying crazy.
That's what we call it. You know, the point about Tech is this, all right? Juggalos today and when Tech came out and ever since, Juggalos seek out, discover, embrace, and fully support innovative, eccentric, independent artists. Juggalos are the concrete that Tech N9ne's empire sits on today. He knows it.
That was a springboard.
And I feel on this show, he should have gave that love. I feel he should have.
And we know why he's not. You know
we understand why he's not.
Totally. He's getting the mainstream success.
He's got all the success. He can say, yeah, man, I come from Juggalos. Juggalos, you know, he renamed them technicians. It's like, come on, man. Mad Juggalos are upset about that. Like, huh? What?
There's a whole other world.
Yeah, man.
They're not writing about this one, boss.
And, like, it just wasn't right that he didn't take this platform, like a respected show like this, and give it up for what's real. Because Juggalos are innovative, supportive people that in bunches support the shit out of you. Rain, snow, don't matter. They're there for you. They love you. They'll support your label. Juggalos, Tech N9ne, right? Has nothing to do with us. For years, people thought we put Tech N9ne out.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? He knows it. We didn't have nothing to do with Tech N9ne. They targeted the Juggalo audience. He started getting some love in Kansas City. I remember the first time we met.
And you haven't reached out to Tech.
Huh?
You never reached out to Tech after the convo up here.
No, we didn't lose what?
You didn't reach out to him after the
interview. I haven't talked to him, no. He changed his number and never gave it to me. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Because I was trying to get him to play the March on Washington. Now, you know, that's a different story. But the problem is, you know, I just feel like I don't like it when rappers say one thing in one place, right? And then go somewhere else and not get that kind of love. Like, okay, the tour Tech N9ne talked about that we put him on, it was called the Wicked Wonka Tour. It was us, Bone Thugs, Cottonmouth Kings. We asked Tech to be on that tour because he was killing it.
In the Juggalo world.
And Tech N9ne had been having vans follow our tour 4 years. Probably.
Something like that, yeah.
Every Juggalo, they targeted Juggalos.
Knowing that they were open to it and supportive.
Yes. And they were giving them love already. So they went directly for that. You know, I just want to reiterate again, Tech has always been respectful and a gentleman. You know what I'm saying? You know, my point, our purpose.
Number love.
So you don't want Juggalos going after his name. That's
man.
Not the point.
They ain't going to do it anyway.
Number
they love
mad
Tech,
love for
you
Tech,
know what I'm saying?
Man.
But we have mad love and respect for Tech. I just wish sometimes on the public platforms like this, he would be a little more
embrace his
coming up, man.
Well, I bet you'll hear. I have a hunch you'll hear from him now.
Well, Tech N9ne heard that shit, and he responded to what they had to say in the interview on a song called Eat It Too with Stevie Stone. That track will be dropped on Stevie Stone's new album, Level Up, dropping very soon. The track was just released. Here's what Tech N9ne had to say in response to ICP. Check it out. After that track was dropped online, ninjas were hitting him up to ask what the fuck was going on. And here is just some quotes from an Instagram conversation that he was having with some ninjas. Check it out. He says, always love. He just feel like I don't show enough love. Damn. What I gotta do? Fuck a Juggalette on Hot 97 and ask her to marry me? Jesus. 40,000 for the gathering instead of 100,000 plus I normally get everywhere else. Ain't that a lot of love by itself? When asked, you couldn't have just called Joe to talk about it? Tech responds, we did. That's the point. He didn't believe me. And I've been sending Tech N9ne history lessons to his phone so he can get my story right next time, and he ain't said nothing back in 4 days. Just remember, I'm an angel and not shady at all. So anything north of goodness ain't true about me. When asked about the paint, he says, since 94. They said I didn't start wearing my paint like I do to their tour in 02, just because my painter was late to the tour, rest his soul. serious shit they had wrong on that interview, and they need to know before they say something else that's wrong. So, shit goddamn, Juggalos, what do you think is gonna happen from all this shit? Got some more ICP news for you ninjas. There's been a lot of ICP news going down as of lately, but check it out. Psychopathic Records has released the infomercial for the upcoming Dark Carnival Games Convention, going down April 21st, 22nd, and 23rd, so that shit's coming up very soon. You are going to get ICP performing back-to-back their classic EPs, Beverly Kills 50187 and The Terror Wheel. Holy shit. This may be the one and only time that you'll ever get to see this shit. Hit up dcgcon.com for more info. Check out the link in the show notes to see the entire infomercial. Check out the announcement right now.
Only for this very special occasion, during the first annual DGC Con concerts, the Insane Clown Posse will perform in their entirety two legendary EPs at one incredible show. Beverly Kills 50187. And The Terror Wheel. What? Don't miss this unique live concert experience of ICP's double EP show. Plus performances by the entire Hatchet family and many more exciting special guests at the Diesel Concert Lounge. Tickets for the after party live concerts will only last until the venue is sold out, at which point you can still buy tickets for the con. But if your ass ain't fast, for these concerts, you get no pass.
That Ninja Young Wicked is going to be dropping his newest album, The Return of the Prodigal Son, very, very soon. Actually, on May 19th, so next month. That shit is creeping up very fast. He has released the track list for the album, and he's kind of done it in a very unique way, actually. He just took a picture of his computer screen with iTunes up with the track list on it, so that's dope. I'm not going to sit here and read off every song on the track list. I will let you ninjas know that none of the features have been revealed as of yet. Although, I think we know that Ritz is featured on the album. I think we know that. Either way, hit up the link in the show notes to see that track list. That's why I'm saying hi whenever I'm awake. Hey. The last piece of news that we have for you ninjas, of course, involves ICP. Check it out. During ICP's visit to Hot 97, which we were talking about earlier on in the episode, Violent J revealed some upcoming plans for touring. They're going to be heading out on the Parental Advisory Tour later this year with Onyx and the Ghetto Boys. And they could also be joined by the DOC, Lil Eazy-E, and Yella, who would be performing some Eazy-E classics, which would be dope. And they also want to tour with Stitches. Check out the sound clip for that shit, ninjas.
We were talking off air, and it was recorded, actually, so I'm going to put a piece of that on the podcast in a little bit, but about how the wrestling world embraced you, right? For a time, WWE embraced you. For a time, WCW embraced you. Yep. Are there other places that you feel in the mainstream world reached out and understood the influence you guys have?
It's all happening now. We're about to do the Parental Advisory Tour, which is sort of like the Bad Guys of the 90s tour. It's going to be us and the Ghetto Boys and Onyx. And I talked to DLC 2 days ago. It's going to be Lil E and Yella doing Eazy songs, which is cool.
All right, Juggalos, we're going to get into our interview that we did with our homie Freaky P. Then we're going to get into a commercial break. And when we get back, we're going to be talking to our homie Sutter Kain. Stick around. It's forever like my life expired. They say I'm not a lyricist. They can talk that shit, but the rhymes that I speak don't last forever. And we on this forever.
My words like vermin, we're certain to spread just like the plague. When I preach a sermon, determined to keep the flock afraid. My wicked conviction pissing in rhythm on the system. When I speak,
I'm here with Freaky P of Replicon Radio. Freaky P, how the hell are you, brother?
What's up, man? Just out here living the dream. Just got done grocery shopping at Walmart, so you know I'm fucking doing it big.
Dope.
Hell yeah, man. No, I appreciate you calling, and shout out to Roscoe and Scotty D and everybody at Faygoluvers for showing us so much love lately, man. That's the shit.
Hell yeah, man. Well, shout out to Replicon Radio, man, because I'm a fan of podcasts. I'm a fan of Replicon Radio. All right, brother.
Yeah, man. We're a fan of you.
Oh, I appreciate that. How did y'all get started? How did Replicon Radio become a podcast?
I'll tell you my story, because there's going to be four different stories. Well, there'll be at least two different versions of this story. One, I actually started Replicon a couple years ago. Years ago, I did radio. I'll backtrack to that in a second, but I quit doing it for a long time. Everything just kind of fell apart. He was doing this show for a while, and he always asked me to come down and, like, check it out or hang out. Like, he appreciated my input and shit. I never really took it serious, to be honest. So I finally went down, and they were doing their thing. And basically, they were looking for help. And it was him and three other guys that you wouldn't know that aren't there anymore. So I just kind of put my input in. Dead Body Man would come down, too. And we both kind of, like, were guests here and there. And we're like, we need to work on this. We need to do this. We need to do that. And then we just became regulars. Then it was me and Dead Body Man. And then Big Rue has been my homie since fucking middle school. So I was like, we need to replace that chair because there's four chairs. You know, there was, and we have a good dynamic. So Rue came down. And even though, we're getting up there in episodes, to us, at least the three of us, we're still really fucking new. Because in our mind, it started fresh the day we joined it. You know what I'm saying? But not to ruin One Eye's legacy, because he's been doing it for a long time. And, you know what I mean? It's his gig he started. To us, it started then, which was, I guess, I don't know, August or September of last year, maybe, is when we kind of stepped in and began the new version of Replicon, which everybody knows right now.
Oh, shit. It was that reason, eh? What number did you jump in? Like, what episode number would you say?
I honestly have no idea, man. I'd have to go back and look.
You guys are almost at, like, 100 episodes right now, right? You guys are, like, 90-something.
I didn't even realize that until you said it, so.
Oh, really? All right, well.
Yeah. Like I said, to us, it's still fairly new, but it's still a big accomplishment, so.
Well, my next question was going to be, do you have anything planned for your 100th episode? But obviously
we're
not.
I'm going to figure it out now.
Right. So what is the My City, My Music platform that you guys released the podcast under?
It's a local radio station here. It's ran by a guy named Justin Kickett, and it was just kind of his dream to do whatever the fuck he wants. You know, fuck the rules, fuck the radio, but let's do radio. You know what I mean? And they started it in his basement a few years back, and they just kind of grow from there. Now they're in a real studio. There's a show every day of the week, sometimes even during there's daytime shows, nighttime shows. He even has his daughter doing a kids show now.
Holy shit.
Yeah, so it's like we're totally different than everybody on there. There's a lot of hip-hop. I mean, we do hip-hop, but it's, you know, it's not fucking Nelly and, you know.
Right.
Little Uzi and shit, like, you know, whatever those groups are called. It's none of that shit, but it's, everybody's down there is cool, man. And it's him and that dude Lockhead, who sometimes you hear on our show. They run the joint. They're basically the boss, but they're cool people, man, and they got the same ideas as we do, not really the same the likes as we do with the Juggalo world and the underground, but obviously they see the numbers and they're cool with it.
Right.
They let us do what we want to do and it works out.
So you all consider yourself a Juggalo podcast or an underground music podcast then?
I don't want to be locked in that cage.
Right. But, I mean, I hear you.
That's what we love. I mean, we all know each other. Besides me and Rue, who know each other from middle school, our friendship has grown because of the Juggalo world, and the rest of us know each other just from being Juggalos in St. Louis and going to shows. I mean, you know, for years now, since the early 90s and shit. We're old as fuck.
How long have you been listening to that underground shit?
I was a kid. Fuck, man. I'll never forget when I first heard of ICP, because that's where it all started. I was living at home. My sister had this weird-ass friend that was into Wicca and shit, and she scared me.
Right.
Because I didn't get that shit. I was like fucking, you know what I mean? I was a little kid. And she came home from the mall. ICP was at a Crestwood Mall here in St. Louis. And they were handing out Riddlebox samplers. She's like, this looks like something you'd like. And I was like into church and shit. I guess it was like 93, I assume, because it was before Riddlebox came out. Or it was probably after it came out when they were like trying to push it or whatever. And it scared the shit out of me, man. I was into church. My buddy spent the night.
You were into church?
Yeah, like, I went to church. Like, I wasn't, like, a Jesus freak or nothing, but, like, I went to, like, youth group and stuff.
Oh,
I mean,
right.
I always listened to, like, Pantera and White Zombie, but that was, like, the furthest. But I was afraid of clowns, and we put this sampler in. My buddy spent the night, we thought chicken hunting was fun, and we like danced to it, or like being silly. And then we listened to the backside where they're like stealing souls in between the snippets.
Right.
And we got scared to death. We stopped it. We couldn't finish it. We stayed up till the sun came up. Like, we kept thinking the clowns were coming to get us. I was scared to death for like a year of this band. But then they like kept showing up. Like, I got a flyer to go to the Omen tour. And then my sister started dating this guy, and he had the Riddlebox tape, and he let me borrow it. And then it just kept popping up in my life, and then I just fell in love. And I went to an in-store right before Malenko came out, and then I went to the Malenko tour here at American Theater. I guess it was 96 or 97 or whatever, and I haven't stopped since. So
now do you listen to like all kinds of different underground shit, though, or is it mostly just Juggalo-related shit?
A little bit. One, I'm super into the super deep underground shit. And he always calls me and Rue Elitis.
Right.
Because I'm all about Magic Ninja, man, right now. Like, I don't think Magic Ninja can do any wrong at the moment. But I have an open, you know what I'm saying? Like, I like some of the stuff. Some of it I don't like. A lot of it, like me personally, there's a lot of just cliche and a lot of underground. And I just, whether they're Juggalo or not, I just set my own standard for, I call it Juggalo rap. And it's when they do shit like this all the time. And it bothers me right away, man. Like, notice some of those artists are dope, and they can write nice lyrics. But as soon as I hear them like rapping like they're trying to be scary, I just turn it off. It's just not for me. Not that they're not good.
Are you familiar at all with Sutter Kain?
Yeah, I mean, I've heard him. I couldn't tell you a song.
Okay.
I know he's been around for a while, and I know he's doing a lot of dope. I know he's doing a lot of dope shit. Is he putting us out something new? Is he promoting a new album? I know you got him on the show.
Yeah, pull the fucking trigger, but yeah, you'll hear all about that later on.
Okay, dope.
Is there anything you want to let the fans know before we take off, brother?
Fuck, man. I feel like there's a million things I could say. Oh, no, that's what I was going to say. I'm going to talk about myself for a second.
You go ahead, brother.
I was going to backtrack just a little. I think it's cool. Some people probably just think it's stupid, but like I said, I used to do radio before Replicon. We had a show. It was me and my buddy, man, and we did really big shit. We stopped in, like, 2012, but I don't know if you remember Underground Psychos Contest, where X-Verter Boys and Boondocks and everybody came from.
Right, yeah.
I used to work with Havoc, the vampire.
Oh, I think I remember him, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Like, he got sixth place at Underground Psychos, and, like, I was his manager and his DJ, and then, like, we did that. We toured. That shit was dope, and then we did the radio show for, like, 4 or 5 years, man, and we did... Like, that's the reason, like, I joined Replicon, because I miss that shit so much. I can tell you stories all day about Havoc. He's gone now. I don't know what the fuck happened to him. Drugs are bad. That's all right. I know, but there's a whole lot to that story. I don't know. It's a tidbit of knowledge for, like, old-school Juggalos. They're like, who am I and why am I doing this? Like, I started there, and, like, we did a lot of shit. That's where the radio started, man, and I just love it. Like, it's fun to be able to... speak your mind and get fucking dope people on and like help spread the word. I'm pretty sure we got Boondocks on next week.
Oh, dope, man. Congrats. I still haven't got nobody from Magic Ninja on my shit yet.
We had them booked, man, and it was their tour was starting the next day. So it was a scheduling conflict. So I'm pretty sure we're rescheduling for the 17th. It's not 100% yet. So if you heard it here first, either I'm lying or you heard it here first. One of the two.
Right.
Mad props to Faygo Lovers. Scotty D, the fucking Illuminati, loves you. And shout out to Roscoe, man. Like, we fucking appreciate all the love you've been giving us, man. It's fucking awesome.
Hell yeah, man. No problem, brother. All right. Thank you
Follow
so much, Freaky P.
Follow us on
Twitter. Follow them on Twitter. We'll check that out in the show note links.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much, man.
All right, man. Thank you.
Get ready for the bloodbath this April as Boondocks brings the Murder 2017 Tour from coast to coast and everywhere in between with special guests Blaze and Lex the Hexmaster. It's Fly or Die.
Behind the rose, not a story or a fable, more of a myth, I suppose. Straight up out the woods with the lumberjack.
The Murder 2017 Tour. Tickets available at MagicNinjaEntertainment.com. VIP packages available at TwistedChop.com. I don't give a fuck, I wanna watch it all burn.
What up, underground hustlers out there? It's your homie, Anybody Killer.
Gangsta!
And I'm hosting the 61st volume of the longest running compilation series in the underground. Underground Hustle.
Sit back and let me take you into the mind of a killer. Yeah. Dark carnival, psychopathic, weak splitter.
Anybody. Hit up the email on your screen and find out how you could be part of the dopest mixtapes in the game.
If I had just one last chance to tell you how I feel, to say, hey, if I had that one last chance,
get your motherfucking
then,
hustle on.
Then I'd be all
peace.
Right. If I had one last chance to say, hey, hey, I would be all right. If I had one last chance to say, hey, hey, I would be all right. If I had just one last chance to tell you how I feel.
Start from building strange music, you know, I make sure there's competition around me that keeps me going. So no matter what we do, what project we do, it's always competition because, you know what I'm saying, we have to rap after each other, or we have to rap with each other, and you know that the fans are going to try to say who did the best, you know what I mean? That's just how it works. Every time we do collabos LPs, I'm blending perfect with all these genres, which I've always done in music. I just want everybody to realize how wonderful that is. And it feels wonderful to me that I'm able to do it. I got something special. I'm so proud to see the growth of the label and to see the other artists gaining fans as well. I'm just happy to still be so tight on my game that I could be a part of it, you know what I mean? And that it could, my name could carry it. It's a lot different than I've ever done in any album. It was a different experience. You know, it's going to keep growing and we're going to keep on doing collabos installments, man, because the music is important to the fans. They love it and they're growing with us. A lot of them are.
Welcome back. I am here with Sutter Kain. Sutter Kain, how the hell are you?
Yo, yo. What's good, yo? You know what I'm saying? Out here chilling, getting it in. What's good, world? You know what I'm saying? Leaving the studio. About to take a nice good food break. You know, trying to get my veganness going on.
We really appreciate you doing this with us, man.
No problem. Yo. I appreciate y'all. You know what I'm saying? Y'all been down with me for a long time. Yo, it's been a long time coming. Y'all been down for a minute. And I appreciate y'all even reaching out to me to do the interview.
Hell yeah, brother.
I know we're supposed to have been done it, but I've been like extremely busy. We've been missing each other, but I'm glad we finally got a chance to do it right now. So I appreciate the opportunity.
Right, man. Well, that underground horror shit, that underground wicked shit, right? Of course, Faygoluvers.
Yeah. Definitely, man.
So right off the top, man, I want to ask you, what is Pull the Fucking Trigger?
Pull the Fucking Trigger is my new super group, I would say. And it consists of me on the beats and Donnie Darko. If you've been a longtime fan of myself and Never So Deep Records, everybody knows who Darko is. So it's me, Darko, and a longtime friend of mine who I've known since, for those who've been following me, since the first Suicide Kings album that dropped in 98, it was a guy named Apollo Valdez. He was part of a group called Seven Signs. And Seven Signs was like my first real rap group that I was a part of and produced. And it's us three in it. So basically it's Sutter Kain, Donnie Darko, and Apollo Valdez is the group. I had an idea for this group like a year ago, but it was with another artist. And then I ran into Apollo and was like, man, I actually need a third artist. So that's when I got up with him. and it actually worked out really good. So right now we're really focused on this project here. We're about like 8 tracks into the album. The album's almost done. We already dropped 2 videos, and we're dropping 2 more videos, God willing, in the next, I want to say the next week, we're dropping 1 more video, and then we're dropping the following one, then we're going to be ready for the album. But right now, as we speak, we have 2 dope videos out, Night Vision and Slums. And that basically tells you who Pull the Fucking Trigger is. And as far as production goes, we got like an array of producers on this one. And one thing about me, I always produce anything that's coming out Never So Deep. It's mostly my production. I say about 95% of it. So if anybody was ever fans of, like, you know what I'm saying, Sutter Kain, Darko, whatever, anything that has a Never So Deep stamp on it, 9 times out of 10, I did the production. You feel what I'm saying? Because I really feel there's nobody fucking with me at all when it comes to beats, like, whatsoever. I'm a producer first, rapper second. So long story short, on this project, I actually had some outside producers come in, like Swollen Members, Rob the Viking. Me and Rob the Viking are really cool. Yeah, so I got him doing production on it. He has a single after this one. He's got the single that's going to be released before the album drops to really push the album. Not saying like that, but it's like we were saving like that one for like the real push one. But yeah, we got a single with him, with Rob the Viking. And then I got a lot of in-house producers I got that I've known for a while. So it's got an array of people on it, man. I got my homeboy Frosty Finn, Johnny Slash, a couple of people. But like I said, I'm real picky when it comes to beats because I really don't think nobody can fuck with me. So it's right. Like if I get a beat, yeah. So if I get a beat from someone for a project, that means I respect that person. I think their beats are really good. You feel what I'm saying? Because it's really hard for me to be like, okay, you know what, y'all, I'm going to get this person to do this and that. I'm really hands-on with my own shit. I follow like the old school Cash Money mantra. Like if you remember the old Cash Money albums, they always had Manny Fresh do everything. Like they never had outside producers and no feature. That's the motto I had for a long time, but I finally broke that mold and started doing other things. So yeah, that's Pull the Fucking Trigger though, but it's like hardcore. Basically, with Pull the Fucking Trigger, I wanted it to be a hardcore hip hop album. I'm talking about the straight up, this fucking hip hop, and that's it, the straight up hardcore shit. I mean, the name says it all, yo, the straight lyrics. I wanted that project to be nothing but lyrics, like some old school 98, 94 type shit, where it's just nothing but fucking lyrics and hard beats, like, you feel what I'm saying?
Right.
And stuff. Yeah, I even pull out like an old school SP-1200 and shit, like, this shit is crazy. So basically, like, Night Vision and Slums is the feel of what the project is going to be like. And the song Power, like, them shits is like, damn, man, we got 3 videos. Yeah, Power. So that's going to be what the sound of the project sounds like and the feel that it's going for.
Well, you always kind of incorporate, like, that heavy shit and the horror shit into all of your music.
Yeah, definitely. Speaking of the horror stuff, too, that I definitely got that coming, too, man. Like, no question about it. Like, the brutal shit is still there. And stuff. It's just I'm so ventured out into so many different genres of things that I'm like a one-man band.
Right. Well, where does that horror influence come from?
Life, man. Have you walked outside lately?
Right.
Have you seen the world? So a lot of shit. So instead of me going and blowing somebody's fucking brains out, I just go ahead and just put it on the record, man. It's my therapy for anger, man. Like, I'm learning how to get rid of anger. So that's my therapy for anger has always been is the music. Because if I didn't have the music, I'd probably be, like, doing a lot of other shit. I'm being so real with that. Look, I got a really I don't give a fuck attitude. So that's where the music comes in at is my balance, for real. But I'm a real chill guy, though. Like, I like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I feed animals and stuff. Like, I'm real chill, man. But it's like that side of me is still there. It's still, like, just waiting.
Well, is that where, like, the whole Sutter Kain character comes from? I know there was, like, a transition from DJ Bless.
Exactly. No, exactly, yo. Exactly. That's exactly where it comes from, man. The DJ Bless stuff is more the industry-based stuff. Like, long story short, I got something cooking up right now industry-wise that I can't speak on until contracts are done, but I got something really big financially that's popping off in the industry. That's the DJ Bless thing. The Sutter Kain stuff is more of my independent stuff, like Never So Deep. So, yeah, that's basically my body count to Ice-T, I would say. Like, how Ice-T has Ice-T, then he has body count. So, yeah, it's basically, like, my body count is the Sutter Kain stuff. So it's more like the grungy stuff that I want to do. And that actually works, man. We're living in 2017 where there's really no rules in anything. So that's where exactly where the Sutter Kain stuff comes in at, man. And I love the Sutter Kain stuff. I think the Sutter Kain stuff is dope as shit. It's my hottest selling stuff on Never So Deep, honestly. But if you look at the sales, it's the number one selling of what we do is the Sutter Kain stuff.
Right. Well, speaking of industry shit, you've worked with a lot of big name rappers. How did you get hooked up with these ninjas?
Yo, what happened was, man, I always wanted to be a DJ first, man. My dad is real business minded. And he was like, why play someone else's record when you can make your own? And that made so much sense to me when I was younger. That's when I started getting into, like, production. But before then, I just wanted to be a battle DJ. That's all I wanted to do was just battle and fucking destroy, nigga. That's it. You feel what I'm saying? But when I got into production, it took it to a whole nother level. That's how I switched over. And I did a lot of industry work. I got my first deal with MCA when I was, like, 19. I got my first deal. It was a big deal, man. I mean, I had
it was a really big deal, man. It was one of the biggest deals that they had at that time period. From there, I dropped a project called Infinity the Ghetto Child, which did really good over there. I had two groups signed to MCA, and I had a distribution deal over there. And then from MCA, I went to go work for Capitol. I went to Capitol and worked over there. And then I worked at Atlantic. I learned everything about the industry through my hands-on stuff. And then from there, that's when I went on ahead and did the whole independent stuff with the Sutter Kain, Agency 1994, Donnie Darko, Jim Snuka. That's when my whole, I want to say legacy or trend, that's when it started right then and there about 04, 05, yo. So I basically gave you like a whole synopsis within like from the beginning to like where you would have heard of me at.
So how did you originally get hooked up with that ninja, that Donnie Darko?
Well, long story short, I had found Darko years ago, man. I found Darko when he was like 17. He had won an MC battle. I found him through a friend of mine, brought him to the studio. This is back in the days where you meet an artist and you tell him to rap for you. Like, not like nowadays. Nowadays, I feel like this totally switched up now. Like, nobody does that no more. But back in the days, you would see an artist. Like, say if I met you and you say you was a rapper, I'd have to hear your music. I'd be like, yo, run for me right now. Let me hear something. They don't do that no more. But back in the days, that's how it was. So I made this nigga rap for hours and see how good he really was. When I met Darko, he was good. He had the potential, but he wasn't like how dope he is now and how he grew. Like, he was there, but when I started working with him, it was a whole different ball game. Like, I felt Darko was like an extension of my mind. Like, it was just click. It just clicked, yo. It was just really like a click between us, you know, and we just like had the same mind state and the same type of feeling on where we want to go with the music and everything. So that's how I hooked up with him, was through a friend of mine and everything. And we just became best friends, man, ever since. And so we became really good friends till this day. Like, we still do a lot of records together, man. He's got his thing going, I got my thing going, and getting it going. But like I said, right now I'm really focused on production and putting out dope records, man. Like, right now I just did the Conway record. Conway just got signed to Eminem. I just produced that. I got a Jack Frost record coming out. Jack Frost is with DJ Premier. So, I mean, I got my production, man. Like, I never sleep on my production. That's why I say I'm a producer first, rapper second, man. Because if you really look at it, and this, I'm saying this for people who don't know, you look at my history, I'm always in the game. Like, I'm always in the game. I'm always at the top of the food chain. Like, I'm always there all the time. Like, you found, like, I'm always in the game, no matter what year it is, no matter what it is. Like I said, I just produced Conway. Conway just got signed to Eminem. I just did that. I just produced Jack Frost. Jack Frost is just about to put out an album with DJ Premier. So it's like I'm always got my hands in something. It went from Darko, me and him, to producing him, to producing who I'm producing now, and producing since my whole career. If you really want to know about who I am, like, you'll go to neversodrecords.com and see all my work that I've done in production and all the outside of production I've done. If you even read my Wikipedia page, that's why I said, like, nobody, I feel, has the experience that I've had, and that's how I'm blessed to keep it moving, to keep it going, because of my experience. A lot of these guys you hear from today, don't hear from tomorrow. And I think a lot of these guys' talent just fucking suck. Like, you feel what I'm saying? Like, they're only for the moment, and that's real talk. I think they're really only for the moment. They get a good buzz going for a moment, and then after that, it's like, you don't remember them no more. You feel what I'm saying? Where I got guys who been down on me from the first albums to now. So I got guys who write me letters saying how I changed their life. So it's like, you got to grow. And another thing I wanted to definitely point out, I know I'm jumping off a subject, but it equals into what we're saying, is you got to watch the growth of an artist. Like, you didn't mention Darko. If you listen to Darko's first album to now, he's grown. It's really fucked up when I hear an artist making the same record that he made 10 years ago. That means to tell me you haven't grown any. Your mind hasn't expanded. Like, you still can't be that fucking angry from 10 years ago to now. Your shit had to calm down some. Like, you feel what I'm saying? You had to talk about something else.
Right, no, I totally get you on that, brother. Sometimes they actually do go downhill, though. I'm not going to lie, with artists. Like, their first three records will be good, and then they just fall right the fuck off, right?
You know what it is, man? Yeah, you know what that comes from, man? That comes from not making music for yourself. That comes from trying to follow a trend. Like, I know you got to see this. You in the underground industry, you have to see this. Where you see a guy who will come out, blow up, and then you see 10 other rappers try to follow his same trend instead of just doing yourself, instead of just making music that you like. Because if you make music that you personally like, other people who like what you like will like your stuff. That's how it works. Make music for you, man. So you can't follow these trends, because what happens is this, man. You'll follow a trend, and then that trend will die out, and then you'll die out with that trend. Then you got to start a whole new trend. So by the time you even master that particular trend, the trend's already dead. That's why I say it's always good to make what you feel is best for you. Not for nobody else, for you. Something that you say, you know what, I'm happy with this album. This album sounds dope, or this project sounds dope. I love this song. Like, that's how you got to feel about your own music, yo. Because I'm telling you, when you make music that's outside of that, you never really enjoy it, man. It fucks your soul up. It totally messes with your whole mind and your soul. Like, you never enjoy it.
I don't see how it would be enjoyable just trying to like impersonate another artist. You can have influences and shit, but I don't understand the impersonation aspect of it.
Yeah, man, but even sometimes the influences go overboard. Sometimes you're over-influenced to where it's like, dude, you sound just like this nigga. Like, you know what I'm saying? Instead of just doing you. Music is art, man, so it's like draw your own picture. If you're going to be an artist, then make your own art. Like, don't copy someone else's art. If this is back in the days and you copy someone else's art, man, you look like a biter. Where now it's like, yo, man, just do you. Like, do your own art. So paint your own picture. Paint what you feel in your heart. That's how I look at it for all artists. And that's why I've been able to survive and do what I do. Because if you notice, none of my shit sounds the same and none of my shit clashes with each other. I do my own thing, my own art, my own paintings, my own pictures and stuff. Like, we do our own thing over here, man. So it's like when I work with an artist, I work with an artist on how I see that artist should be painted. I don't work with that artist and say, okay, you know what? I'm going to make a record just like this one. Nah, I do my own shit. Like, you feel what I'm saying? We do our own thing. Like, we speak on shit on records that niggas would never speak on. So that's just how shit goes, man. That's why I think we have such a blessed hardcore fan base, because they know that they're not getting the same redundant record again. Like, they know this record is going to be even better than the last one. It's going to fit to what they're feeling in this life. So basically, if a fan or a follower or whatever you want to call a person who supports you, a supporter, listens to your music, it's about what he's going through in that time period. So it could be, he could listen to my first album because he might be going through that in this time period. He might listen to my new shit because he's going through that in this time period. But it's never the same shit over and fucking over again. Everything is just like brand new and dope. Like right now, I'm in the zone to make lyrical, dope, hardcore music. So that's why I come out with Pull the Fucking Trigger, because that's the mode I'm in right now. So if you're in that lyrical mode, then you would listen to that album. So right. You got aspects of everything. Never So Deep, that was one thing I wanted to make my label very big on. Is versatility, man. It's where you can hear whatever you want on whatever time period you're going through. Like, whatever you're going through, you'll find it at my label.
Well, hey, brother, our website is it's very, like, Juggalo-influenced. Just going to ask your opinion on that. Do you consider yourself a Juggalo, or what's your opinion on the whole Juggalo subculture?
Juggalo subculture is dope. I don't consider myself a Juggalo. I just consider myself me, Sutter Kain, and that's it, or DJ Blast, whatever you want to call me. I consider myself my own person, but I respect everyone. I respect Juggalos, Juggalettes, all that. For real, I respect everyone. I think everyone's dope in their own way and do their own thing, you know, like hands down. And I love this site. I mean, me and Scotty been friends for years, man. I love this site. The site is dope. I always go there, surf it, listen to music and stuff, see what's good and everything, you know. So I definitely support the site 100%. I mean, I support everything out there. Everything I do is really dope and stuff, man, for real. But me personally, I consider myself me.
Well, we appreciate that, brother.
Yeah, definitely, man.
So, hey, man, I wanted to ask about this. There's a lot of, like, religious lyrics in your music. Like, you bring up religion every once in a while.
Yeah.
Where does that influence come from?
Life, man. And stuff is trying to find your way, man. Trying to find your way and trying to find out what fits you. See, one thing about religion, yo, religion is a touchy subject. Everybody's got their own beliefs and their own following systems. Like, I have my belief. Everybody else has their beliefs. So I just incorporate whatever somebody's going through in their life. Like, me, I'm Muslim. I got a lot of people hit me up and be like, yo, man, like, they'll hit me up and be like, man, yo, like, I never believed in anything. But when I started listening to your music, it really opened my mind up to a lot of things. And I was just like, man, you feel what I'm saying? And they switch over and they start living a better life, man. Start seeing things differently. So that was what my whole thing with religion is, that I don't knock no religion. It's all about what you personally believe in. And so it's like, when I rap about my shit, it's what I personally believe in and what I see in life, how I see the world. In my opinion, if you don't, and this is just my opinion on it, if you don't believe in something, it's like you just walk blindly. Like, that's how I put it, man. It's just like, we just didn't end up here. Like, it don't work that way, yo. I mean, science proved it. We just didn't appear here. For me personally, it's like, I try to spit a lot of knowledge that I've learned throughout life into my lyrics or something of that nature. It's to each his own, man. Like, I got friends who are, like, mad different religions. I got Buddhist friends, Christian friends. To me, it's just like, we're all going to die. So it's like, okay. Like, you feel what I'm saying? Like, we're not 100% we're going to die. So it's like,
right.
As long as you live in a good life, man. Let me tell you something. I would never knock a person. As long as you live in a good life and helping the next man, hey, man, high five to you. Like, personally, I do my own thing, man. And so, like I said, man, I feed straight animals. I'm a heavy animal activist. Like, I love animals, for real. Humans, I can't really speak on. Animals, I fucking love. Like, you feel what I'm saying? So,
right.
For me, it's just opening up my mind. And honestly, I wouldn't be like that until I got into Islam. Like, honestly, before then, I was a fucking, I didn't give a shit about nothing and stuff. Like, I can piss on you and fucking, you can be on fire and I walk right by you and be like, let's get something to eat. Like, you feel what I'm saying? Where until I got into religious aspects of life, that I started seeing things differently and started being held accountable for my shit that I do in life, for real. And it just opened my mind up to, like, loving animals and people and shit, seriously. Like, how animals have their own thing. Like, animals have their own their own community, their own everything. So I look at shit like that, man. And I'm not the only one. Like, even Daniel Gunn. Daniel Gunn's a huge animal activist, like a fucking huge one. But you would never know it. And so, like, we don't really broadcast all that shit, man. We just try to just live our life and do what's best in life and call it a day.
I'm not going to lie, homie. That kind of surprised me when you just let me know that.
Yeah, I love animals, man. I love animals, dude. I fucking love animals, yo. Animals are loyal. They don't fucking bother you. They mind their business. They do their thing. Like, I love animals, man. I fucking beyond love animals. Like, me personally, I wish that, this is real talk, people who hunt animals, like, for sport, I wish they would round them up and have people hunt them. Like, you get what I'm saying?
So, yeah,
for
I do, real. Yeah.
Like, I had a thought for my next video. It's like, I'm really heavy into filmmaking right now. My next video, I was going to do that. I was going to have it to where we round up people and we keep them like in dog cages, like how they do animals. Like, we keep them in dog cages and we have them fight each other and we treat them like fucking, like, we treat them how the human beings treat animals nowadays.
Right.
I can't fucking stand rednecks, including them. Like, you feel what I'm saying? Like, it's just, to hunt an animal for a sport is fucking stupid. That's the dumbest shit I've ever fucking seen in my life. You hunt an animal, either you're going to eat the animal or that's it. Like, that's what it was for. When the Indians used to kill the buffalo, they used to thank the buffalo and say, thank you for letting me eat you. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, they respected it. It wasn't just a sport. It wasn't a sport at all. When I see that shit, it makes me want to just fucking kill them. Like, it's fucking stupid. It's completely, like, idiotic. It's, like, completely fucking idiotic, yo. And I think everybody should help an animal. I really believe that. Like, if you see a stray cat, help the fucking stray cat. If you see a stray dog, help the fucking dog, man. Like, let me kick your fucking kid and put it out there and just let it fucking roam. That's the shit that pisses me off. That's why when people say, I had a lot of people say, like, well, I would choose a human over an animal. Well, something of that nature. And I'm like, hell no. Fuck no. Because a human can always talk and say, yo, there's something wrong with me. An animal can't do that. If an animal's hurt, it just fucking hurt. It can't do nothing. Where a human, even a fucking baby, can still figure it out. Like, that's how I look at a lot of things in life, man.
Sutter Kain, in your opinion, who is just fucking killing it in the underground right now?
Me and my company.
I knew you were gonna say that. I knew you were gonna say that.
Yeah, pull a fucking trigger. I think we're totally killing it right now.
All right, outside of y'all, who do you think is killing shit?
Outside of us, I would say this dude named Black out of Springfield, Massachusetts. He's killing it right now. That nigga's sick as fuck and everything. I think he's really good. If you look up Black 2004, I produced that shit. That dude is beast. I think he's really killing it right now. I think he's that next one out. Like, no question about it. He's doing really good. Cool in his area. Like, he controls his area. Springfield and stuff, yo, like in Massachusetts, like, he controls that area. So for a guy to control an area in 2017, it says a lot. That's the one who's breaking out, this guy named Black. Black is really breaking out. Black and Dirty White, them two are really breaking out right now, I feel. Like, those are the next ones. I think those are the guys you're going to be hearing about in the next year, where you're going to be like, damn, he told me about them. And so I think they're really breaking out heavy.
I ask this question every single episode of the podcast to every artist. Mm-hmm. If you were stranded on a deserted island, you can only have 3 CDs with you to listen to. What 3 CDs would you have?
Yeah, that's a good one, man. I'll tell you that off the bat. Okay, I would have... I got some good ones for you, too. A top 3. Just give me 1 second. I know it would be the first Razzcast album, Soul on Ice. Soul on Ice to me is a classic album. I used to love that album. Razzcast, Soul on Ice. I would have... minus, like, 2 songs, the first Body Count album I thought was classic.
What 2 songs? I gotta ask now.
I forgot, man. That's a good question. I got to look at the...
There's just 2 that you skip every time, right?
Yeah, it was one I thought was okay, but I thought the rest of the album was classic. The Voodoo one I thought was kind of whack. I thought that was kind of lame. I thought that was kind of like, he could have took that off the album. So I thought that was all right. Then there was another one. You know what's a good funny one? Is Evil Dick. I thought Evil Dick was funny as shit. But I think it was one more, man. I forgot what it was. It was the one that they used for the soundtrack for Universal Soldiers. I thought that was the second one. They could have skipped by that one. Yeah, those 2 they could have skipped by. I thought those are the 2. When I listen to the album, I'm always skipping. Like, that's okay. But the rest of the album is fucking classic. Okay, I said Razzcast, Body Count. Third and final one will probably be the Killer Priest album, Heavy Mental. I thought Heavy Mental was a classic. Heavy Mental is a fucking classic album. To me, Heavy Mental is the best Wu-Tang album ever, in my opinion. I think it's better than Liquid Swords. I think it's better than Return of the
36. Wow, really?
I think it's better than, oh, hell yeah. Killer Priest, that was a classic album, man. And cool at the time period, man, when I was really trying to find life and listen to a lot of music that taught about, like, because you gotta remember, before the internet, that's how we used to learn, is listen to the music. That's how you learn what was going on. Like, honestly, that's how I learned. Wu-Tang showed me a lot. Like, I ain't gonna lie. And right. Stuff, yo. I'm not even gonna sit here in front on that. You know, like, I learned a ton of shit. And then when I started hearing Killer Priest had the same belief system as I had, I was like, oh, this dude gets it. Like, waiting on spaceships and shit. Like, I was heavy into, like, UFO shit at the time. And until this day, I still am, but not as much now, but I still am, though. Like, if you listen to a lot of my music, I talk a lot about aliens and UFOs and shit. Like, I was heavy, cool in that time. When that album came out, I was heavy into it. So when I heard him speaking about spaceships and shit, I thought that was like, man, he gets it. Like, he knows me. Like, he knows me. So I thought Heavy Mental is a fucking classic album. Every single song in that album I thought was really dope. So Heavy Mental was good. So if I was stranded on a desert island, I would have those three, I would say. Like, I would have my hype shit, my learning shit, and then my life shit. I think that would be dope on a desert island.
Well, I got to check out that Razzcast because I've never heard of that shit before.
Yeah, check out the first album, Soul on Ice. All his new shit is okay, but the first album is really good. Soul on Ice is really good. I think it was A Live and Die in Miami, I think. Something like that. I thought it was from Miami for the longest. It's actually from, like, L.A. somewhere, or Oakland, or some shit. But yeah, it's a dope album. Rockstar Soul on Ice is a really good album.
We're getting to the end here, so is there anything that you want to let us know, anything that you want to let the fans know before we take off?
Yeah, man, check out the new projects we got coming out. We got Pull the Fucking Trigger. I got the new Sutter Kain album dropping really soon. I got a super group with me, Daniel Gunn. Daniel Gunn's fucking from Germany. He's huge over there. This dude's fucking, I mean, averages like a million plays on YouTube. This dude's fucking huge. And we got a group called Hashtag Murder. And we released a new single recently that's doing really good. It's called Murder on 42nd. Definitely check those out, man. But the main thing, check out that Pull the Fucking Trigger. That's what I'm pushing heavy right now. And then right after that, we got the Sutter Kain. Everything out of Never So Deep Records, man. Never So Deep Records is where it's at. That's how we're rocking it, man. It's up www.neversodeeprecords.com.
Hell yeah. And look for...
Follow me on Instagram, too.
Instagram, look for links for all that shit in the show notes of this, too.
Nice. There you go, man. Hell yeah. So, you know what I'm saying? Making it rock and getting it happen, man. But I definitely appreciate y'all, man. And stuff for real. Let me ask you a question. If you were stranded on a desert island, what's your three records?
Oh, shit. You know what? I've already answered this question on two other episodes of this, but...
No shit.
I got ICP Great Malenko.
I heard Drake Malenko. Speaking of Drake Malenko, not even to cut you off, as a friend of mine, this was years ago before I even heard of ICP. He was heavy into that particular album. He used to always talk about that album.
I don't know, man. To me, that's the power album for, like, not just for the group, but for the whole, like, record label. Twisted, Most Tasteless, and Crash Test Dummies, The Ghost That Haunts Me Now.
Nice. You like Crash Test Dummies?
Oh, hell yeah, brother. I would
never strike you as a Crash Test Dummy person.
I grew up with that shit, man. It's not stuff I listen to anymore, but... That album has, like, sentimental value to me, right?
That's how I feel about the albums I told you. That's what I'm saying. That's exactly how you feel about the albums I told you. It has sentimental values. Now, if you would have gave me a top 5 or a top 10, I would have got even deeper.
Oh,
instead
right.
of a top 3, that's cool for right there.
Right. Yeah, it's only an hour-long show.
I feel you, bro. I feel you, man. Well, I appreciate it, man. Thank you so much, dude. I definitely appreciate it. Like I said, y'all, make sure to check out the Pull the Fucking Trigger, Hashtag Murder, Sutter Kain, Donnie Darko, everything on NeverSoDeepRecords.com. You know what I'm saying? For real, y'all heard it here first. You're a Lamborghini,
sip martinis, look hot in a bikini. You better work, bitch. Yeah, I can't believe Britney's still getting paid, man. She's been around a long time. I feel like I grew up on Britney.
Britney Spears is weird, man. She blows up and slims down, gets bald, grows a wig.
When she was bald and swinging her cane and all that, I just wanted to meet her because I felt like she was vulnerable.
Right, she took it like right back to the 80s, like a Scarface movie, you know what I'm saying? Right in the... You know what I'm saying?
She had a whole mental breakdown and all that. That leads to some extra hot loving, in my opinion.
Hot chicks always have a mental breakdown. You never see a fat, ugly chick having a breakdown because they're busy handling their business, slapping their kids around, you know what I'm saying? Worried about the next meal and...
Why, when a hottie like Britney Spears has a mental breakdown, that's sexy. You know what I'm saying?
Because you know they don't care. They'll just tear your meat up, dog. Because
they gotta have a mental breakdown if they're gonna let you hit it. You know what I'm saying? In their right mind, they would never let somebody like us near it. But when they're having a mental breakdown, your chances increase. Big time.
I don't know what drug she was on when she was bald, but it definitely wasn't crack or meth. You know what I'm saying? Because she went the opposite way. She went out, not in.
That's when she looked the best. When she had some meat on her bones, man. See, the thing is, normal Britney, calm Britney, it's no fun.
Well, maybe this song is like a tribute to that Britney. She's like, work, bitch, work harder.
Keep
work
working.
Harder, and I'll shave my wig back off, and I'll start plugging the meth up my ass.
Worker, worker, worker.
Until she snaps.
Until she snaps.
Right.
And then we reap the rewards.
That's right, and so do average ninjas. Even Kevin Federer was just some average ninja, and he ended up getting in good with it for a couple years, getting paid. And then he got that mad successful rap career.
That's going to do it for this episode of the podcast. I want to thank all of you ninjas for tuning in. I want to throw a big thank you over to our homie Sutter Kain. Thank you so much, homie. It was a very interesting conversation. Hit up nsddigital.com or hit him up on Instagram, instagram.com/SutterKainNSD. Our homie Mars, who we talked to on the podcast last week, has announced a release date for his upcoming single Creatures of the Night featuring Tech N9ne and Twisted, and that shit is going to be dropping on April 17th. Keep your eyes and ears peeled for that, ninjas. I want to throw a big thank you over to my homie Freaky P of Replicon Radio. I actually want to throw a shout out to all the ninjas over on Replicon Radio. Freaky P, Big Roo, One Eye J, and of course, Dead Body Man. Continue to stay fresh, ninjas. Hit us up on iTunes, give the show a 4 or 5 star review, and I will read your shit on the air. Until next time, ninjas, this is your homie Roscoe reminding you to keep an open mind. Peace.
Yo, I was raised in the land of the greedy, with fellas rock slinging the grams of the peaty, and hella's high flames is expanding the eating. A shell of shot blazing, you drop, feel the pain in the anguish, you bleeding. Take a dance with the demons, I'd rather not claim. I'm a man full of meaning, spit the petrol octane, super flammable speaking. I stand undefeated, I scan and see the flames, they can scam, then you scheming. When niggas get touching, then my hands get the feeling. Some trigger grip busting, how your family grieving, and this shit is disgusting. To kill us, it's nothing, use scissor tips, how your head split in discussion, that's the end of discussion. Your life ain't important when niggas sniff something, brain white can't support it. Tainted thoughts is so trite, you can't ignore it. I never could draw, that's why I write painted portraits. Straight from out the streets, my niggas up in the slum. Getting lit, they cop a blizzard, throw the funk in the blood. Getting laced while you feel the bass bumping and thump. Family, I guarantee to have a something to cut. Okay, now don't be getting busy, acting croak cause you drunk. Throw you blows and then you dizzy, taking nothing from chumps. But I know if you're feeling froggy, motherfucker, then jump. We got the pump in the trunk, so what the fuck do you want, nigga?
I talk it because I live it. I walk it because I did it. That haters, they try to mimic, it's different. You Tony, I'm Sosa. I'm the hardest, you bitch niggas atrocha. I have you sleeping with the frogs and the croakers. Your baby mama stroker, the bitch a freak and I choke her. Live life, I live right, but live life, that's my kid life. She won't see no hood life, I done earned stripes. Every booth, I burn mic. Cause it's too hot, your buzz ain't shit, I'm killing the hype. I'm still in the fight, punching and grabbing, killing his life. And his wife mouth stay on my lap, killing my pipe. I'm like, never polite, this nigga breaking the pain. This gun is a new addition, you can't handle the rain. I told you it ain't a game, stay in your fucking lane.
Nose with the bullet the size of a plantain. Keep my niggas up in the club. Getting lit, they cop a blizzard, throw the funk in the blood. Getting laced while you feel the bass bumping and thump. Family, I guarantee to have a something to cut. Okay, now don't be getting busy, acting croak cause you drunk. Throw you blows and then you busy, taking nothing from chumps. But I'm not if you're feeling froggy, motherfucker, then jump. We got the pump in the trunk, so what the fuck do you want? You have to...
Is there anything specific you want to talk about?
This is my new projects and stuff. I got a lot of new projects dropping out, so I just want to promote this new... I got a new group called Pull the Fucking Trigger, so I'm really promoting the shit out of that right now. And
yeah.
I got like a new... I got that and the hashtag Murder Project. I got a couple of good projects that's really dropping. I'm only focused on that, but anything you want, I'll give a fuck. I'm game. But definitely won't put out there with the project, though. Cool enough, Pull the Fucking Trigger.
That was actually my first question was going to be, what is Pull the Fucking Trigger? So that works perfect.
Yeah. Perfect. Okay, cool. Yeah, I'm pretty sure you, man, you're a professional interviewer. You know what time it is, man. Like, I'm pretty sure you do all your research and stuff.